for me, stroke it for me. Ooh, baby, I love your stroke. Cause you, cause you come anywhere, cause you go anywhere I'm going. I'm sure you'd get my vote. Cause I believe you know just what you're doing now. Now we can
coast. Let's go.
Let's don't get in a hurry. No, that's too slow.
Hey.
Go ahead and put that thing in motion.
And now an important message from Jerry Rice.
As a career wide receiver, I've been hit hard. But no training nor practice prepared us for the devastation of COVID-19. I know it hit home for a lot of you, and it has been a challenging year. Thankfully, there is hope. Even with multiple vaccines available, we still have to work together until everyone is safe. If we all continue to do our part, keep practicing the necessary guidelines, we can bring back our small businesses, send our kids back to school safely, and see you all in the stadiums again. No one person ever wins the game alone. It takes teamwork to beat a tough opponent. We all win when we unite to prevent.
For more information, visit unitetoprevent.org.
Have you been getting IRS balance due notices in the mail? Do you owe back taxes with growing penalties and interest? Have you not filed tax returns in several years? Are you being audited by the IRS? You can't fight the IRS alone. You'll get creamed. Listen each week to Taxing Times for the latest income tax developments, current tax news and information, and strategies to solve your IRS tax problems.
Make sure you tune in to federal tax attorney and CPA Mark Klecka every Tuesday at 5 p.m. right here on The Real 1100.
WWE Lakeville, AM 1100.
The following program is paid for by Influencer 365. The views expressed do not necessarily reflect the views of this station, its management, or the Beasley Media Group.
It may not mean nothing to y'all, but understand nothing was done for me. So I don't plan on stopping at all.
And we are back right here on the Real 1100 AM. I'm your host, KC Pratt, the rock star himself. Thank y'all so much for joining us right here. iHeartRadio, checking in all over the world. My folks in India, I see y'all. My folks in Africa, my folks all the way out in Europe, my folks in China, my folks out in Mexico, and everybody across the nation. I can't believe how many folks we got listening now. Whew! Let me calm down. I've been running all day. Jeff ain't got his butt back in the studio yet, but it's all right. We're going to have a good show anyway. Just to get some announcements out of the way, because I got a special guest in here today. And I promise you, I want to give them as much time as I possibly can. But just to get a couple quick announcements out of the way, if you are out in the Douglasville area and you want to look fly and sexy like me and get that fresh cut, I want y'all to go visit my good friends over at Studio 1211 Barbershop. We got a full stock shop. We got all kind of barbers in there. You can get any style that you want in your hair. And you can see them right there at 6405 Fairburn Road, right there in Douglasville, Georgia. You can Google them and just Google Studio 1211 anywhere in the Douglasville area. I promise you, you're going to get all the information. You'll see all the beautiful five-star reviews. I mean, it is a great, great place. And you can see from my haircut, my barber know what he's doing. Next, if you out in the Smyrna area, I want you to go visit my good friends over at Titans Fitness. They keeping the rock star fit. They keeping me buff. They keeping me... Well, they got me losing weight right now. I don't need to lose no more. But You can go see my good friends over at Titans. You can visit and ask for Rachel Stucker. That is my personal trainer. She is a part of Impact Fitness. She is a world champion, IFBB Pro, and she is training the Rockstar himself for his first competition next year in June. So I want all y'all to come out and support me for that. But right now, I want y'all to go over to 1835 South Cobb Industrial Boulevard, Southeast, and you can visit Titans, or you can find them online at titans.net. Tell them KC sent you, and Rachel will give you a free training on me. Next, the mastermind is now sold out, and Jeff is finally getting to work. We see you, Jeff. Everybody, see you walking through the door. All right. I keep trying to tell him, bro, we got a strict time schedule to stick to.
Under the bus. See how you push it?
You knew I was going to get you, bro.
Under the bus, man.
You knew I was going to get you. But the mastermind for February is now sold out completely. You need to make sure that you take advantage of this mastermind. If you want to make sure that you have a successful year, you want to make sure that you are doing the right things to move things forward. It is time to get rid of these fakes and these phonies and these gurus with this bad advice, trying to sell y'all a whole bunch of marketing instead of showing y'all what really, really works.
What'd you say about my daddy?
Don't even start today, bro. But no, seriously, man, this mastermind, just watching these people, you know, as the lights started to turn on, when they started to see it, and they was like, what? I ain't need to run all them Facebook ads. Yeah. I really ain't need to spend all that money on Facebook. You know what I'm saying? Because too many times we listening to marketing instead of listening to the real advice from people that's really doing it and people that's done tried and failed. And trust me, like I tell folks all the time, I fail my way to success. So I know what don't work.
Yeah.
But we also know what do. So we will be having another mastermind in March. So everybody can still take advantage of this thing. It is never too late to get your business right, get your money right, and start moving in the right direction.
Yes. Yes. Now, are we ready for the marketing minute?
Are we ready for the marketing minute? I thought you was going to do a shout out real quick, but you know.
No. We going to get straight into the marketing minute, man. The marketing minute of the day is know your audience. Do not try to sell Ben a Benz when he's 10. So here's the deal. A lot of us are trying to sell a product and we tell them features and stuff, and we don't know our audience. Now, Ben may be a male. He may like cars. He may like Benzes, but Ben is 10. So he's not your ideal audience.
Hey, man.
So stop spending all this money and doing all this to try to sell Benz to Ben when he's 10. Know your audience. That's your marketing message for the day from the smartest working man in growth business, Mr. Marketology, and the rock star, Brandon, KC Pride.
Woo! I ain't know if I'm going to get a shout out at the end of that one.
I shouldn't have after you pushed me under the bus. I still got tire marks on me, bro.
That's all right, man. I still love you, bro. But in studio with me today, I just couldn't wait to get to it, man, because I am so excited and I'm so honored just to be able to sit here with this man. He is a world gold medalist Olympian.
Gold.
All right? He ain't come home with the bronze. Oh, all right?
Not the silver.
I ain't talking about nobody that got the bronze, because we proud of y'all too if you got it for the United States. But
but he won't let us hold it though.
I know he'll never bring the medals with him.
Yeah.
Said, you ain't touch my medal.
And you ain't run with me in the race.
But now this man is an author, he's a life coach, and he's just an awesome individual. He's doing so much to help families and children. He's done so much in me personally in my life to help me out as well. So welcome to the program, Dr. Eric Merriweather.
Hello, listeners. I am so honored to be here. Thanks to KC Pride and his co-host. I think this is going to be a fantastic day.
It is.
Oh, yeah. Man, what you got going on?
Man, I'm telling you, there's a lot of things happening in 2022 with the nonprofit organization, right?
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we know we still got COVID going around, so our numbers are steadily increasing at the nonprofit. And the name of the nonprofit is the African American Association of Georgia. And also new for 2022 is the African American Association of USA.
Wow.
So we want to take this to a different level, so to speak. We don't want to just be state oriented. We want to be nationally oriented.
Oh, yeah.
Meaning that we want to be able to help people across the board, whether it's in the state of Georgia or outside of the state of Georgia. But everything started here in Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay.
Some 20 years ago.
Wow. 20 years.
20 years.
20 years.
Full grown.
It is literally
y'all more legal.
Absolutely. The baby has grown up and the baby is full grown. And I think it's time to take this to a total different level when it comes to the organization and what we want to do for our families in 2022.
Let me tell y'all a story about this, man. Like, seriously. So everybody knows that we did the first ever Atlanta Business Journal holiday party, right? Right before Dr. Eric called me. He said, man, I can't make it. I said, I got to have you there, man. He said, I'm sorry, Kev. I just can't do it. He said, but I got a donation for you and all this type of stuff. I said, all right. So I'm riding. We trying to get all these toys from this. And you remember how many toys and stuff we had?
Yeah, it was a lot. Yeah.
So we got the little 328 pack, bro. Like, I got a little beam. I mean, a little beam.
Yeah,
I mean, it's the same pack.
Upgrade your beam.
Yes, sir.
Everybody keep telling, I don't like them big bodies no more, man. I love my little small guy. I can whip in and out. But no, seriously, we got this thing packed down to the rim with toys. And I'm thinking I'm finna go over here and pick up a bag of toys, right? He said, stop over here by the warehouse. I knew something wasn't right when he said warehouse. He said, stop over here by the warehouse. I got some stuff for you. And number one, bruh, four cases.
Yeah.
Four cases of toys for kids. I mean, we were able to help so many just off that one donation. Like, I know at least 50, 60 kids we was able to give a toy to just for them to have something and say, hey, we care about you. You deserve to have something for Christmas just like everybody else. So I have got to commend you. And like I say, then on top of that, I told them, I said, look, I got a special family that they don't have anything for Christmas. The mom is just distraught and this type of stuff. I said, it's a young man. It's a young boy and it's a little girl. He filled a bag just full of toys. I mean, we were able to put toys all around that tree and give those folks a full Christmas because of you, man. And I can't commend you enough for that. I just can't. I appreciate you and I love you for it, brother. Because just to be able to put that smile on the folks' face like that for Christmas, because I know what it's like. You know, at Christmas time and your kids, everybody deserves something. Everybody wants something and this type of thing. And you can't do it as a parent. I didn't had a year like that.
Absolutely.
It is something that just, it breaks your heart as a parent. And to be able to put a smile on that family's face, man, all because of you, I got to commend you for that, really.
Well, I just want to say in regards to that, you know, we knew that the families were in need. So we like creating big smiles for our families, right?
Yes, you do.
Not only with toys, but with food, toiletries, and everything else that we get from our donors. So we are not the organization that gives you a small box just to carry you for a few days. Mm-hmm. We like to give you anywhere between 250, 350 pounds of product every time you come.
He is not lying, brother.
Wow. Because we really want to focus on the sustainability for food, right? So that families can focus on creating a better atmosphere for themselves. Because, you know, I heard on the radio coming in here, mental illness, there's so many things going on. But if you're dealing with food insecurities, it's rather difficult, not only for a child to focus in a classroom, but it's difficult to just pay attention to your surroundings and everything that's going on with you in life if you're starving. Yeah. So we just want to make sure that they're taken care of. But it was an honor that, you know, you called me to do something that we love to do anyway. And we were hoping with everything that we put together that the families know that they are loved, that they are cared about, and we want to do everything we can to make them whole again. So we want to keep them focused on being great while we help them with the food sustainability.
Now let's get back to the beginning of this baby. Okay. All right, let's go to the newborn part. Because seriously, for you to go see this organization, like when I walked inside that building, and you see this big, huge warehouse. I'm talking about they got so much stuff in there, like Walmart almost. And all this is stuff that they're giving away.
Yeah.
And you started all this out your garage.
I started it out of my garage. And, you know, that's one of the things that we're going to go by for the anniversary is the premise of starting out of the garage with 30 families.
Wow.
Oh. So you just imagine you just having enough for 30 people in your garage. Right. And you start off with these families because these are individuals that I coach. Also, it's kids that I work with with track and field. And I always find them in need of food when we travel, in need of clothing, in need of toiletries and all these things. So I found myself purchasing this stuff for these individuals. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden there's this thing. I call it God.
Hell yeah.
So I won't put a thing on it, but I'll call it God. I felt like I had a visit and gave me the name of the organization, which started off as the African American Association of Georgia, to do this thing. And I was like, no, you got the wrong person. Go get somebody else. I'm not doing this, right? Wow. Because of what the requirements were, you know. But I was like, I'm doing this already, and this is something that I love to do. Mm-hmm. And just watching the smiles on each of the kids' face was the ammunition that I needed to do what I'm doing now. So after doing all of that and going through this whole process, because, you know, starting a nonprofit is not easy.
No, it's not. Mm-hmm. That 501c3 paperwork alone ain't easy.
The good thing is I was fortunate because God told me to do it. And I'll share this with your listeners because this is going to let them know that the organization is blessed. I filled out the paperwork myself, sent it off July 14th, had it back in the mail approved on August the 14th.
Wow.
So we're talking less than 26 days. And I say to the listeners, when God tells you to do something and you're obedient in what he tells you to do, he is definitely in the blessing business.
Amen.
So we have been blessed to the point of growth that we went from 30 families a month. And here we are entering into our 20-year anniversary, and we are now serving 1,100 families a month, which equates to close to 30,000 people a year.
Wow.
So that's a lot of people because the average family is anywhere between 3 to 5 children per family. So it's a lot. We do a lot of events throughout the year that we focus on Black History Month, which is the thing that we're doing next month. Mm-hmm. We focus, of course, we do this health and wellness thing throughout the summer.
Okay.
Of course, Thanksgiving, Christmas, which are our busiest times of the year. We get, oh my God, the numbers just increased totally. But our donors have been very good to us, especially the last 2 to 3 years with COVID hitting. Mm-hmm. Our donors have been spectacular, and I can't thank them enough. But of course, I'm going to shout them out.
Go ahead.
Oh, if you want me to do it now, I'll shout them out now.
Real, they deserve it.
I want to say thank you to Feed the Children. I want to say thank you to Midwest Food Bank. I want to say thank you to Convoy of Hope. I want to say thank you to Good 360. There's just so many people involved, not only from a personal perspective, but a corporate perspective as well. Even a shout out to PepsiCo and Frito-Lay and the things that they've done to help our organization with some new programs that we're instituting in 2022 as well. So I'm really, really excited. And 2022, I mean, we better dance because you're starting off in 2002, and here you are 20 years later.
Wow.
Most nonprofits, they say, don't make it past, I would say, 1 to 3 years.
Wow.
And here we are 20 years later doing what we love to do.
And yes, it's so significant. Yeah. It is so significant. And it's funny. I remember when me and Michelle had this conversation from success. You know, that's the first thing in your career.
Yeah.
To significance.
Yeah,
and this is one of those type things. It's like helping that many people. One big thing I just got to ask, you know, what was it in you that made you take up this mantle and decide this is my responsibility to take care of all these folks? Because you are an accomplished man. You are a doctor. I mean, you're an author. I mean, a best-selling author on top of that, mm-hmm. and a gold medalist Olympian. You're a busy man.
That doesn't let us hold no medals.
Exactly. He don't bring it with him.
You guys are still on this medal thing, but what? one of the things for me is that the kids are so important to me because I was a kid once, right? Mm-hmm. And there are things that I went through that I just don't wish on people, you know? Whether it's, you know, it's the things that I talk about in my book, dealing with molestation, dealing with rape, and having to deal with those issues can really mess with your mental psyche.
Oh, yeah.
So for me, you know, it was just about just giving back, helping people to get whole like I've gotten whole, you know, not being a victim anymore, but being a victor.
That's,
you know,
big. Wow.
It is like, because if you lay in being a victim, that will, for me, be the destruction of your life. Because as a victim, you have a tendency to do things to feel good, but you're connecting to the wrong things to feel good.
Wow.
And one of the things that I had to focus on was self-identity in order to help other people to know what it's like to self-identify with who you are. not what your mother told you, not what your father told you, not what the people around you or the kids in school say to you, but who are you?
Mm-hmm.
Trust your belief. When you have belief of greatness, trust it. Don't let anybody else shoot that down.
That whole message is so powerful because, you know, I grew up in a dysfunctional family, similar to a lot of stuff that you have gone through in your life. And one thing that I found was that moment I took responsibility, because I was angry as hell in my 20s. And I did all kind of just bad stuff. That's why I do so much good stuff now to try to make up for it.
You're still angry sometimes, though.
Don't get me started.
I think we all can go there.
But y'all ain't had to go through this divorce. I had to go through
Here we go.
Don't get me started. But now the real part, it was when I took responsibility.
Yeah.
It was like, look, yes, this happened to you.
Yeah.
But you don't have to keep perpetuating this and doing this stuff to other people.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what I found so powerful. So I love that you speak to that whole letting go of that victim mentality. Because as long as you're a victim of somebody else, you can't fix it.
Yeah. And it's easy to be that victim, because one of the things that I've realized is sometimes it feels good to get the pity party.
Yeah.
So you're like, oh, how was your day? Oh, man, I'm just trying to make it. Oh, I'm going through this. Oh, I'm going through that. And you start to feed off of the attention that you get from being a victim, instead of saying, you know what, I'm not a victim and I can get over this and I have bigger dreams. Because one of the things I've realized, even in my life, once you become that victim, you start to limit your dream. Absolutely. You don't even know how to dream big anymore. You just like, well, I'm just trying to make it through the day.
Everything about what happened to me.
So, you know, with the organization, I just felt like I had to do that, right? Because most of the kids, well, not most of them, but some of them have experienced some of the same stuff that I experienced. So it was easy for me to identify the kids with self-esteem issues, the confidence and the lack thereof.
Speak to that for a second. Why is it? And don't get me wrong, but why is it so many times as children, the stuff that happens to us, we internalize this as our fault? Not that daddy just wasn't right, someone wrong with him or whatever. Something wrong with me. Why do we do that as children?
So my biggest thing with that, and this is something I talk about a lot when it comes to truth versus interpretation, right? Okay. So as children, when we grow up, we can only interpret who our parents are, right? And our interpretation sometimes become our truth, when in fact we're still living off of interpretation, because our parents are not honest with us as children.
Oh, yeah.
They don't share with us the bad things that they did. They don't share with us the bad things that they've experienced, you know? And I feel like if a parent is honest and truthful with their children, they give them the ability to make the right decision.
Wow.
But when you hide things from your children, a lot of times they end up reliving the same life that you had.
Mm.
So you didn't pass on to the generation coming after you with your truth. You should have shared your truth versus us having to relive that experience of what you've already experienced.
That is so
true.
That
is true.
Because for real, because a lot of times you just keep living that same thing, trying to fix it, I guess, somehow.
Yeah.
But it's like you end up in bad relationships and everything that you went through, you end up perpetuating that same cycle all over again. And I don't know if it's a thing that we're trying to fix it for ourselves or what, but it's just.
Well, I've noticed even in our living in society, a lot of us co-sign on lies and we don't tell the truth. I mean, we'll see it in the media and we'll say, oh, yeah, well, if you don't say anything, you're co-signing on that lie.
Yep,
instead of saying, no, this is really happening. So, for instance, little example, we're here in Georgia. We may have some weather and people call from out of town and say, man, I heard a tornado rip through Atlanta. And you're like, nah, not where I live. But you, you know, you co-signed. Oh, man, it was hard. We was in the house all day. Man, it was
don't know
sunny.
What happened.
Yeah, we didn't even know until you called that there was even any weather. But we co-signed on so many things on the lie instead of just saying, no, this is in my interpretation of the truth. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's with that I think we should communicate more.
Yeah.
And we should communicate more in truth.
Wow.
Versus having to be seen a certain way by saying certain words to make you look a certain way.
Yeah.
Just be honest with who you are.
Wow.
Because my course and everything that I've done over this last 20 years with this organization has taught me to be intentional about who I am. And when you're intentional about who you are, then it has the ability to set the boundaries without you even opening your mouth.
Wow.
Wow.
This seemed like the theme for the week, right?
It is.
Be intentional.
Be intentional. Plan.
Be intentional.
Plan.
Absolutely. Be intentional. Even if it's a nonprofit that you're starting, be intentional about that. But also be prepared to give your entire personal life up for a nonprofit, because it requires you to do a lot in the beginning. You're the new kid on the block. The donors don't know you. The partners don't know you. They want to get to know you, but everything has proven ground. You have to go through a proving process. And I am happy to say that we have been so fortunate with the African American Association to help so many people. And I know some listeners might say African American Association. We're not only focused on the African American, that's a big key component to it, but we believe that there's connectivity everywhere.
Wow.
Despite ethnicity, there's connectivity.
Yeah.
You look at me, ancestry DNA, I'm British, I'm German, I'm West Africa. So it's like there's a lot of components to us, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We just have to identify with who we are, what we represent, and set a better level of expectation for ourselves.
Wow.
Stop allowing people, and this is what we try to teach the kids that we're working with the nonprofit, is just really identifying who you are, who your circle is, so that you make sure that you attach to the right people that can create growth.
Yeah,
because if you don't, then you flatline, because everybody around you is just like you, and it causes you to flatline because you have all these victims around you when you need to get three different levels of people. And my three levels for that is: one, you get a group that's beneath you, one, you get a group that's on the same level as you, and then one, you get a group above you. The group beneath you is for you to look at to see where you don't want to go again. The group that's on the same level as you, there's people doing the exact same thing you do for betterment of life.
Okay.
And then the people above you have the ability to pull you up even to greater heights and deeper depths for yourself.
Wow.
Yeah.
We got Michael Fleming. He chimed in. He said he's supposed to be doing some work with you this year.
Absolutely. And I cannot wait to work with Michael, because that's one of the programs that we're going to be working on, bringing people in so that they can identify their circles, so that they can understand who they really are. Because I think a lot of people are, I call it sight unseen, where you, you're only reacting to what you see, right? We have a front lobe and we have a back lobe. Your back lobe hides the stuff that most of us don't want to deal with. But if you start to deal with that and you start to look at things from the back lobe, you can create the space for growth, because, you know, they say you are what you are.
Yeah.
So if you're attracting certain things, stop attracting based on sight, but attract what you can't see. Because even God says eyes have not seen nor ear heard. So if you work from a perspective of the unheard and the unseen, then you don't give people the ability to step on your stuff or hold you accountable for a dream that's only meant for you.
Wow.
Wow.
I told you, bro. I told you. Every time he come in, he going to drop it.
Sometimes you don't want to know who you really are, though. Sometimes you be like, I don't want to be him.
Oh, but you got to, though. That's the thing that I had to do with the organization. I denied it, you know, because what God showed me is an education sports complex for the organization.
Okay.
Where we deal with education, where we deal with food insecurities, where we deal with family and issues with finances, on getting bank accounts, because all this subprime lending is destructive.
Yes, it is.
It is very destructive. So we want people to understand what credit represents. We want them to understand what livelihood looks like, and we want them to understand what success looks like. So at the organization, we focus on the food to help with food sustainability, so that we can help the families focus on their future.
Now we fast there. This segment has gone so fast, but I definitely got to get some of this stuff out, man. You up for a lifetime achievement award after all these other ones he got? This man got award after, I think he got awarded by everybody in the state of Georgia at this point. But now you're up for a lifetime achievement award. What does it feel like to just with this body of work behind you, you know, to now see that you're getting this lifetime achievement award? What does that feel like for you?
So the lifetime achievement award happened on December 4th.
Okay.
Wow.
So this is my second one. The first one was from President Barack Obama.
Wow.
Where's the clap?
I know, right?
And the second one that I just received is from our new president, President Biden.
Oh, wow.
So, yes. I know. Yes. So I am excited to the point because it's a representation not only of growth, it's a representation of significance. It's a representation of us being accountable and responsible for the community that we serve.
Wow.
So I'm honored by that. I've received awards from the Georgia Senate. I've received a proclamation from Congressman Hank Johnson. And then also we are now part of South Fulton. Really? So we are no longer part of Atlanta, but we are part of South Fulton. I am proud to say that the South Fulton Police Department has adopted our organization, if that's the right word to say. But they have come by. They like what we do, and I'm just looking forward to the future of doing something not only with them, but also having the opportunity to meet with the new mayor of South Fulton so that we can put some plans together to help these families that are in need.
Now, I just got to get this out because I know he's such a humble man. He ain't going to talk about it. But we got just a few minutes left in this segment, so I definitely want to get your book out, you know, knowing your identity, because I know that it's such a powerful book and people really need to hear about it. If you can just spend just a couple minutes telling us about your book and then how people can get it.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about the book and then I'm going to drop the information about the nonprofit because I want to challenge some people.
All right.
I'm done with this. The book is called Knowing Your Identity Through Christ. And like I said, it talks about a lot of stuff that happens in the African-American community in the 60s, the 50s, the molestation, the rape, the incest, you name it, things that you've experienced, the abuse in the household.
Oh, yeah.
So I talk about the struggles of going through that and what it felt like being a kid at the age of two when you're witnessing your mother being abused by the man that's supposed to be your father. Mm-hmm. But the abuse, I can share this very quickly with the listeners, was about me not being his son.
Wow. Mm.
That's what he would get her for. So imagine what it did for my identity and knowing who I was. And
it
just
had to make you feel bad.
It made me feel bad. But 2 years ago, we did a DNA and come to find out he is my father.
Oh, wow.
So
did that make you feel worse when you found out he was your real father?
I would say that because there was a part of me that didn't want him to be so that I could be justified in my actions.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
But it didn't come out like that. It came out that he was my father, but it also made me look at him differently to do that to my mother when I was his the entire time. So it made me feel a certain way, but I believe it created growth. So I no longer had to wonder about my identity. Now I know. So I'm able to lead and help other people get there in spite of circumstances.
It's so beautiful when you look back and you finally see why God put you through it.
Absolutely.
It is an amazing experience.
Absolutely.
Now, how can folks support the organization and give us this challenge? Because I'm on it. I'm going to do it.
Okay. So the book itself, you can go to knowingyouridentity.com to purchase the book if you want to purchase the book. And we're going to be coming out with some new things concerning knowing your identity as well that I've shared with KC here. But it's something once we get trademarked and all that other stuff, then we'll bring that to the light of what we're doing.
Okay.
But again, to celebrate this 20th anniversary for our organization, which is the African-American Association of Georgia, the African-American Association of USA, my challenge is to not only city leaders, it's to business owners, it's to anybody that's an entrepreneur or just loving kids. Mm-hmm. I'm challenging you to support this 20-year anniversary for more growth for the organization and what that looks like. More growth financially, because on average with the donors, they give us product, but we are still responsible for getting the product there.
Okay.
We're spending close to maybe $200,000 a year with freight costs. So if there's people that have trucking companies that want to donate, people that want to donate to our organization for this 20-year anniversary so that we can expand with more programs to help our youth grow. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things that we're doing with Michael Fleming. Our website is theaaausa.org. And also our phone number is 866-305-0572. But I'm saying get involved in any way you can, monetarily, from a volunteer standpoint, from in-kind donations. We take it all, because I know you have a family. Everybody's connected to someone that needs something, and we want to be that group to be there for your family. So when you're thinking about us, think about your family smiling after they come to visit, but also think about you being part of a great system to make a family whole again.
Wow.
Cool. When I talk about somebody that's selfless, somebody that's really in it for the right reasons, Dr. Eric Merriweather is the one. I promise you. This ain't about him. It ain't about his awards. It's really about helping his family.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, I'm going to take the good old doctor out to the parking lot. We're going to race real quick. As quick as he really say he is.
He's going to burn you out, bro.
And I hope my kids are listening, because they know I'm up for a challenge. I want them.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to the number one rated business show right here on the Real 1100 AM iHeartRadio, checking in all over the world. You got the rock star, Mr. Marketology himself. We'll be back after this.
Hi, this is Dr. Williams with Align for Life Wellness. I want to invite you to our new office at 1800 Jonesboro Road in Atlanta. Come in for a consultation, examination, therapy, and x-ray, all for just $100.
What?
Yes, $100. This offer expires soon, so call us to schedule at 404-383-1110 or find us on the web at www.yourfinespine.com.
If you want to be fine, take care of your spine.
We're open late.
So, what's the asking price on these houses?
You'd probably be more comfortable living somewhere else.
How long is the lease?
Sure, you can afford to live here, but...
How are the schools?
We have twins.
This neighborhood probably wouldn't be right for your kids.
If a real estate or rental agent says anything like this, you are being discriminated against, and it is illegal. If you experience housing discrimination, go to hud.gov/fairhousing and report it. Fair housing. The law is on your side. A message from HUD in partnership with the National Fair Housing Alliance.
Have you been looking for a radio station that gives you sports?
I don't believe it! Oh. It's a touchdown!
Entertainment?
Are you not entertained?
And other special interest talk shows?
Well, isn't that special?
All on one app?
Yo, that's dope. What app is that?
It's the Real 1100 AM app for WWE. Grab it for free in your Google Play or Apple App Store today.
This is Abdul Chestnut of AEMG TV and XOD Network. I'm here getting it in with my man Casey Pride, the host of the number one rated business show.
Are we jamming today? We are back right here on the Real 1100 AM and iHeartRadio, checking in all over the world. Thank y'all so much for joining. And we're about to have a conversation about the future.
A future.
The future.
The future is here.
The future is now, brother.
Yep.
Joining us to the program, he is an expert in artificial intelligence. Now, I've been telling y'all for years, it's coming. Now it's here. Now it's taking
First
jobs.
First of all, I have a problem. See, I was working at the store.
Uh-huh.
Thought I was doing a good job. Then all of a sudden they put in this AI, and all of a sudden I'm just sitting on the curb looking at everybody do their own thing because the machine is taking my job. Now, what are we gonna talk about that?
I'm trying to tell you. Matter of fact, we finna get into it because he probably fault. He probably created it.
Nah, I'm just playing. It's deeper than that. It's much deeper than that.
Joining us to the program, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jerry Abiog.
Hey,
did I get it right?
Yeah, you did. You did. You said you're from Alabama, but you guys beat my Bearcats.
All right.
Oh, man, yeah, you're so a big cop,
yeah,
man.
Yeah,
so but sad. Them dogs beat that Roll Tide, too, though. So I ain't mad about it.
It's sad because we weren't supposed to be there in the final.
Y'all had a good year, though.
Yeah, thank you.
Y'all had an excellent year, actually.
Well, Jared, we definitely want to jump into this conversation with you, man, because artificial intelligence now is literally the way. It's the future, and it's absorbing jobs. I know we joke about it, but it is absorbing jobs like you cannot believe. And this artificial intelligence, it don't sleep. It don't take a day off.
Yeah,
it don't take a week vacation like Jeff, but
I was sick,
and it don't get sick, though, and it don't catch COVID. So, give us just a little background about your business and you being in this artificial space, in this intelligent space.
Yeah, so I'm one of the four co-founders of Standard Insights.
Okay.
And it's an AI as a service marketing platform.
Wow.
And okay. what we do is we help businesses leverage their first party data
okay.
to help them drive growth and improve their market share.
Wow.
So basically what we would do, we would pull data either from your point of sale system, mm-hmm. e-commerce and spreadsheets, run it through our AI engine.
Mm-hmm.
And we can help that business target the right person with the right product at the right time.
Wow.
And why is this helpful to that business? Well, it helps them. We can help them, you know, target the right person, but it helps them improve sales. Mm-hmm. It helps them improve average order value.
Oh, yeah.
It helps them improve or reduce customer churn.
Oh, yeah.
And you guys had mentioned about, you know, AI taking jobs. We're in the middle of a labor shortage right now, whether you're the low wage, mid wage or high wage job. So now mm-hmm. AI is going to be more prevalent.
Oh, yeah.
Now and going forward.
Yeah. But you're starting to see a big change in it, because even with marketing, it is so much data out there now that
yeah.
you feed these AI engines.
Oh, I
and they
it.
Go pull all this stuff. They know what yeah. ads gonna work. They know how yeah. to rewrite that copy for you. They know exactly how to pull them keywords. It's just such an amazing ability to have.
I love it. It's like a magic trick. I mean, you literally can be talking about something and all of a sudden pull up your phone and be like, wow, that came up.
Yep.
And it we think it's magic, but it's not magic.
It's
intentional. And like he was saying, think about this. You go to a store, you're like, I don't really know what I want just, but I know I want something. And then all of a sudden you get this idea out of nowhere that says, hey, you want this? And you're like, yeah, I do want that. And pick it up. It makes your life so much easier.
Oh, yeah.
It's like some person living in your brain.
It is.
Knowing how you're going to, what you're going to do next.
Yeah.
And to your point, Casey, it's all about the data.
Oh, yeah.
And we've seen it. I mean, it's in our daily lives with Amazon and their product recommendations, Netflix and their movie recommendations, Tesla and their self-driving cars.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But now as AI has become democratized, it's available now to the small, mid-sized businesses,
mm-hmm.
Provided they have enough data. And what, you know, in the past, these AI tools were reserved for the Fortune 500 companies.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
your brick and mortar store, your brick and mortar
You're
restaurant.
Breaking it down to small yeah. business. Anybody can take advantage.
Yeah. Wow.
Now, explain this to me, because a lot of folks get confused with machine learning.
Yeah.
They don't really understand. It's like, what does it mean? What is machine learning and all this type of stuff? When we start talking about artificial intelligence and really the power of it, can you just lend a little bit to that conversation about machine learning to explain to people this is what's happening with this thing and this is why it's growing so fast?
So AI, just a high level definition, is getting a computer to think and act like a human. And then machine learning is a subset of AI, and it's different machine learning algorithms that you give instructions to the computer
mm-hmm.
and to tell it what to do.
Wow.
So for example, for our, you know, platform, we can take customer data, we can take purchase data and take a look at what Casey's predicted to buy or what Jeff is predicted to buy, and then execute campaigns around that. So when you get that email text, you're likely to buy.
Hey, Jeff, you want to stop at McDonald's today and get this Big Mac?
You're going to get off my Hey. I'm not going to say anything about it because everybody knows. I'll be at the drive-thru.
So AI, speaking of McDonald's, AI is just a fancy version of saying, would you like fries with that?
Yeah.
So wow. McDonald's made a lot of money way back when. Would you like fries with that? Now we have all this data coming from, you know, everywhere. We got our phones now, right?
Yeah.
We didn't have it not that long ago. I'm 50 years old. I didn't even have an email when I was graduated from college.
Wow.
Right. So now we got this data, and now with AI, the AI algorithms, which has been around for a while now, businesses can take advantage of it.
It's so amazing, because nowadays, if your company ain't got a database, or if it ain't got some type of data insights that you carrying along with it, ain't no value, bro.
And if you
don't nobody care.
And if you don't know how to interpret the data.
Oh, yeah.
That's another thing. People have a whole lot of contacts in their list and this, that, but they're not actually looking at any type of behavioral information to make any decisions off of. And that's what makes AI so great. It's like, okay, we understand. And then there are platforms like social media where everybody tell their business.
I know.
And they just let you know.
But they have no clue what's happening. Data, as you had pointed out, right? You know, what's your customer ordering and how do you act on it?
Yeah.
Now, let's talk about that, because we really, really harp on, you know, understanding your numbers, understanding where your customers come from, and this type of stuff. how should business owners be processing their data? And what data do they need to collect?
Well, that's could be a wide, varied question, but the basics is their customer data.
Okay.
Like, you know, customer comes in, first time visitor to your restaurant or your store, maybe mm-hmm. have them fill out a survey. I know that's a pain in the ass, mm-hmm. but, you know, give them a discount, maybe just demographic, geographic info, just to get a baseline understanding of okay. who you are.
Mm-hmm.
And it may just give you generic recommendations. But as you come in to that restaurant or that store, it learns and compares your purchase patterns, what you've done in the past, and other people like you.
Okay.
And that's how it gets smarter and smarter over time.
Does it tap into other data sources? Like, for instance, once you put in your name and stuff, I know there's certain companies out there that actually goes and trolls. Wow. Well, I'm not gonna say trolls.
Is it trolls? They
actually get all
looks
your
for.
Yeah, they look for all your information on all your socials, on this, yeah. and they compile it.
Okay. Yeah, it can.
Okay. Wow. Yeah.
But, you know, really, you look at your phone, you look at your bank apps, every time you sign up for a new app, it asks permission for you. Can I access your pictures and all that?
Oh, yeah.
And you could say no, then you can't use the app.
Yeah.
But it's just a part of daily life.
Now, I'm glad you mentioned that, because I think we was having this conversation the other day. You know, because a lot of technologies nowadays rely on apps and stuff on your phones to mm-hmm. read everything on your phone, and folks don't know it. But companies like Apple now are telling on them. Because I constantly get, you know, that notification pops up and says, hey, this person been tracking you for the last 2 days. You might want to cut this off.
That's corporate warfare right there.
But no, but how does that affect what you guys are doing, though? That's my question. Does that affect the information that you guys can collect?
So that's a good point, and that's a great question. Because if you, I don't know if you realize this, but third-party cookies are going away.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that means that if you go to a website, they can't track you to other websites you go to. So now it's going to be more important for that business owner to really get that first party data, you know, in line,
really understand that customer
really
journey,
understand that customer journey.
Yeah.
Because if you don't do that, you fail in customer experience, and that customer can go to the competitor, a mile, 2 miles down the road.
Yeah. Now, I'm gonna put this on Jeff, or push this towards Jeff, cause he is Mr. Marketology. How long before you take over his job? And we don't even need his mind anymore.
He's already trying. I mean, you 2 minutes late for work, and he's already like, how can we get the machine to sit in his place?
But no, seriously, because you got to think about it. At this point, these AIs have enough information. It's so much stuff out there, and they have enough databases to tap into. I mean, they can damn near create this stuff themselves.
Yeah, but you never want AI or a piece of software or an app just to run by itself. So it's going to be a hybrid of humans, Jeff.
Okay.
And
I'm necessary.
I'm glad he gave you your job back.
So we'll
he gave you your job back. Because I was going to stand the inside name.
But what happens is, and I always tell people, like, hey, you don't need my, you don't need, you know, the software. So, and you go, okay, maybe. And I go, hey, Jeff, here's this exercise. Here's a list of 2,000 customers. Here's a list of 500 products. Now identify what each of those customers are likely to buy amongst the 500 products.
It would take almost 6 months.
Yeah. And so now we have it set up. It can do that in a snap of a.
Now, how important is it for these businesses to be early adopters? Because I remember back in the days when the internet came around, they were like, I don't need a website. I don't need this
network. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's a great point. So when the company first started, like three and a half years ago, I remember I was out in a trade show in Denver wearing my trade show badge. I was at a happy hour and someone asked me, you know, what I did. And I told him, hey, you know, I co-founded at that time, just started an AI software company.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're taking my jobs away. But now, fast forward, we're, 2 years into COVID?
Mm-hmm.
You're making my job so easier.
You're making my job so easier.
Yeah.
I can't find a marketing person.
Wow.
Or I need someone to analyze this data. It's going to cost me at least $100,000 to hire a data scientist.
Yeah.
We can do that at a fraction of a price. So to your point of the early adopters, this COVID thing,
yeah,
these last 2 years has helped the tech companies out.
Wow.
That's big.
Now, speak back to that. You know, folks, y'all taking my jobs. And we do see now machines are running a lot more stuff than what they used to, because factories, most of that is ran by computers. When you go to the grocery store now, you got one cashier and by 50 registers. that everybody checking themselves out. So a lot of this type of stuff, it is starting to take over. Even at McDonald's, it's self-service now.
Yeah. So to your point, we're facing inflation.
Okay.
Right? From a wage inflation and then the price inflation. So when we're going to the gas pump, when we're going to Mickey D's or what have you, buying that beer, it's more expensive than it was, you know, 6 months ago. So we have product inflation. Then now we have wage inflation too, because you talk to any restaurant owner, they can't find workers. And if they've got, you know, a willing party, well, I was paying the, you know, dishwasher $10 an hour. Now they want 20. That's 100% increase. Well, what does that mean? Well, you got to increase everyone's salary. 100%. And that now that $10 burger becomes a $20 burger.
I was going to say, Jeff ain't going to pay $20 for that Big Mac.
I'm paying my share. But it also helps businesses with their actual customer experience.
Yeah.
Because a lot of these jobs, pre-COVID, pre-pandemic, people act as if they didn't want to work there. They have attitudes. They act this, that. Now it's like you can be replaced. And so a machine isn't going to give you attitude. Hopefully they won't start giving us attitude. So,
but yeah, you're absolutely right. But it's always a hybrid, right? So for example, you know, a restaurant that at time, you know, maybe pre-COVID, it took a wait staff of 10 to run it. But now you can't find a wait staff of 10. Maybe you can only find a wait staff of 3, and everyone like wants their pay raise. So now what's a happy medium? Well, with an AI driven ordering app, it can predict, if you go to that restaurant often, it can predict that you may like, beef dishes with a certain type of beer, and maybe you like chicken dishes with a certain type of wine. So now
he know us so well, Jeff.
Yeah,
he must have ran a scan on us.
He
scanned you guys before you came in here. Now, if you're that restaurant owner, you may not need to have a wait staff of 10. You may only need a wait staff of 3, and you can pay those 3 or 4 people the wage they want, and everything else can be taken care of by the software.
Okay.
So now it's a hybrid approach, and giving it back to what we talked about. You're a marketing person, so we're not going to get rid of it, Jeff.
I know, man. I need my job. I need my job.
Now, one of the biggest things that the things that most computers don't do well is that original creativity. Like, it can mimic anything it's seen before. It can find what works best, but it can't do the creative part yet. How long before we see that these things can think and start designing and putting all this stuff together on its own?
No, I'm sure there are platforms out there, AI-driven platforms, that help out with that creativity mindset, whether you're writing or creating ads or what have you. Yeah, there are.
No, I know those, but when it actually comes to like the design portion, because we've got programs that will tell you, all right, it'll scan the design and say, all right, this is what everybody's gonna pay attention to, but it can't come up with that original idea.
Yeah.
So does AI ever get to that point, or being a creative still always gonna be that key in this whole marketing world?
So it's gonna be both.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Maybe started by the person, but you know, helped, bolstered by an AI software platform.
Okay.
So yeah, it's gonna be both. You're never ever gonna eliminate the human component to it. And you shouldn't, just like with a self-driving car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, go ahead.
Oh, I love the fact that you can bridge now though the offline and online experience.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
That you actually can look at behaviors in a whole new way. And you can take that for a better experience. And I think businesses should think about this. It's all about the experience.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that's something that a lot of businesses fail, because they sit in a boardroom, and in the boardroom is a good idea, but only to the people in the boardroom. And they don't look at that experience.
Yeah, you made a good point with customer experience. I mean, if you go to our website, the first thing on there is customer experience. Yes, everyone, like every software person or every consultant is going to tell you, hey, we're going to help drive sales, improve in efficiencies, you know, same with us, but let's peel back the layers of the onion, and using data, we can help improve the customer experience by presenting you guys the products that you're likely to buy, preventing customer indecision, and telling the customer what to do next. So if you can get that, summarize that and get that going, then that business will sustain a bigger competitive advantage than someone who doesn't.
Now, I can't believe the hour's up already. Like, we are zooming through this show, But real quick, how can people get in contact with Standard Insights? How can people start using this software and start applying this to their own businesses?
Yeah, so they can reach out to me. I'll give them my email. It's Jerry, J-E-R-R-Y, at standardinsights.io. It's all spelled out. You can go to the website, standardinsights.io, and there's a place for a book a conversation, book a demo. Or lastly, look me up on LinkedIn, Jerry, J-E-R-R-Y, Abiog, A-B-I-O-G, Standard Insights. I'm the only one there.
Now just because we got you a customer sitting in here with you today, how can this technology help nonprofits? How can they help them do their job better?
So we would have to analyze their customer data in whatever actions that they want someone to take. So maybe we can analyze profitability scoring, or take a look at these folks are more, will donate a lot higher than maybe these folks, and target the messaging around that.
Wow.
So
wow. That's powerful.
That's big, man.
Yeah.
And like, I got one question.
Sure.
When can I be turned into a cyborg? And then I'm going to take the doctor out to the parking lot and we're going to race.
AI cannot help you with that, brother. Yeah. Trust me, that human right there going to tear you up. I can't wait. We got to record this after the show.
Tell you what, I mean, if you watch the wild card games, AI is being used in football, because every fourth down situation, should we go for it or should we punt?
Wow.
And there's a little there's a little ticker in the bottom. If you watch, like 45%, if you go with the run play, maybe 48%, 49% if you go with the pass play.
Wow.
Now it's up to the coach and the players and the what you're feeling at that time. But AI is being implemented now as we speak in football.
Falcons, y'all need to hire them.
I was going
to
say, y'all need to get Stan Insight for the Falcons.
Because obviously they're not looking at the data.
They don't know what to do on first down, let alone fourth. But no, man, thank you so much for coming in, man. I am so excited and just so floored. I can't wait to go check out the technology myself, because I know what the power of this AI, and I know what it can do for folks, and I know what it does for a lot of folks' businesses.
Yes.
So I am so happy that you were able to come in and share this with us today. Unfortunately, our time is up. Right here on the Real 1100 AM, we will be back tomorrow at 3 o'clock. Jeff, you got anything, man?
Man, I'm just warming up. I'm stretching.
I think
right
Jeff
now.
Over here trying to give a resume.
Right,
I think he's trying to get a job interview.
No, nah, you trying to get me fired. You up here talking about CGI him. We're going to CGI him from this point on.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. It has been another episode of the Number One Rated Business Show right here on the Real 1100 AM, checking in all over the world through iHeartRadio. It is the rock star himself, Mr. Marketology, and we are out.
Name basis in your city faded off the brown. Nino, she insists she got more class. We know swimming in the money, come and find me. Nemo, if I was at